Hello, my name is Jonathan Grandidier and I work at the NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California. And I'm going to talk today about power beaming for deep space and permanently shadowed regions. So I'd like to thank my co-authors, Malcolm Wright, Dimitri Krut, Bill Nismith, John Brophy, and John Elliott from JPL and from Boeing Spectrolab. This is the outline of my talk. I will first discuss the objectives and technology description. Then I will present the power beaming facility at JPL. Then indium gallium arsenide laser power converter or LPC device result. Then a comparison between solar photovoltaics and power beaming. And finally, I will show some examples of end-to-end power systems utilizing power beaming. So the objective is to assess the technical feasibility of using an advanced laser power converter, LPC, to achieve high optical to electrical conversion efficiency. So we can see on the left, power beaming, where we have here a laser for electrical to optical conversion that's transmitting through the air or vacuum. And then the receiver is a LPC, in this case, an indium gallium arsenide laser power converter, similar to a solar cell, for optical to electrical conversion. So we have three types of power beaming, a short-term one, which is short distance for surface-to-surface power beaming. And one application is the permanently shadowed regions of the moon's Shackleton crater or cavern regions. Mid-term application, which is a longer distance for orbit to surface beaming at the moon near the sun. And an example is powering landers and rovers from orbiting spacecraft on the moon, Mars, Europa, or Enceladus. And then we have a very far-term application with a very high power beaming at distances very far from the sun. And this would be for transmitting power to outer planet beyond Jupiter. So this is the technology description. So on the left, we have the mid-term application that I described, where we have an orbiting solar-powered vehicle that provides power to a lunar base during the lunar night. And on the right, the shorter-term application where power beaming to a rover from a lander at the rim of the crater into the rover in the permanently shadowed Shackleton crater on the moon. So there are some past experience of power beaming. For example, NRL demonstrated recently transmission of 400 watts of power using large components across 325 meters with a near-infrared laser that was at 1064 nanometer. And prior to that, EADS rover power beaming demonstration, the transmission distance was between 30 meters and 200 meters, and the power level was 4.3 watts using a 532 nanometer laser, and that was back in 2004. So the concept is that laser power beaming enables the transmission of power without wire. The objective is to charge a small robotic power system located in a permanently shadowed region, PSR, from a solar power lander located at the rim of a crater, and or to power lunar base from an orbiter during the lunar night. So the image on the left shows a terrestrial free space power beaming demonstration that I described earlier, and that was done at NRL in 2019. And this image here shows the concept where we have the lander on the rim that beams power to the rover, which is inside the PSR. And communication is done between the rover and the lander on the rim, then from the lander to the orbiting spacecraft, and then from the orbiting spacecraft back to Earth. And on the left here, we have a block diagram for the end-to-end power beaming system, where we have a photovoltaic array to power the laser with a DC-DC isolated converter. So that would be the emitter. Then we are beaming power with a laser, and we have a receiver, which is here, has some LPC cells. Then another DC-DC isolated converter, and the load, which is in this case could be the rover. So for this end-to-end system, we have several subsystems, and I listed some of the major ones on the right. So we have the laser and the optical element. So continuous fiber laser here is used to beam 1 kilowatt of optical laser power at 1064 nanometer. And the laser includes optical element receiver diameter beam at 15 kilometer target. So that would be for the rim to crater example, or at a 65,000 kilometer target if we consider the orbit to surface case. Then we have thermal management. So to generate 1 kilowatt of optical laser beam, 3 kilowatt electric of power is needed, assuming a 33% efficient fiber laser, and 2 kilowatt of heat needs to be rejected. This requires, we calculated this requires a 4 meter square radiator for continuous operation. Then the laser power converter, here we consider indium gallium arsenide LPC, that eventually at the far term would operate with a 65% efficiency for optical to electrical conversion efficiency. And with a 1.1 EV band gap, indium gallium arsenide is well tuned for optimum conversion efficiency at 1064 nanometer wavelengths. And then the power electronics. So we are considering gallium nitride based DC-DC converter modules for a step up and step down conversion at 1 kilowatt with 95% efficiency from 100 volt to 1.5 kilovolt. So this is a breakdown of mass of all the subsystem for the application, the short-term application where we have the lander at the rim. And then we have, it's composed of a laser of 20 kilogram. Then we have a 20 centimeter aperture optical element of 10 kilogram, the power electronics, a 12 kilogram thermal management system. So a 3 kilowatt solar array to power the laser would weigh around 14 kilogram, and the tracking element about 8 kilogram. So that's for the transmitter. And on the receiver side, we are considering a battery that would charge in 6.2 hours, assuming the laser from the lander on the rim. And that would provide enough power or battery for 20 hours of roving. And that would be about 36 kilograms of battery. Then we have the LPC and the power electronics, which is overall less than a kilogram. So this is a table with comparison between solar photovoltaics and power beaming. So the example of permanently shadowed regions, such as the Moon-Shackleton crater, wouldn't be achievable with standard photovoltaics, because it's shadowed, there is no access to the sun. So in this case, power beaming could be a mission enabler, as opposed to solar photovoltaics. And if we consider a 1 kilowatt laser at 1064 nanometer, and the LPC tuned for this wavelengths with 65% efficiency, we would generate 650 watts. Then for the case of continuous power throughout the lunar night, so this could be achieved with a solar array combined with a battery or chemical energy storage, but that would require a large amount of chemical energy storage to go through the long lunar night. And power beaming from orbits on an orbiter always illuminated by the sun would significantly reduce the chemical energy storage. So this is scalable because as opposed to a solar array, we could have a receiver on the surface of the moon and an orbiter that provide power with a laser beam. And we could consider having a second orbiter that provide laser power to the same receiver and double the amount of power on the receiver. So that's what we mean by scalable. Then the case of the shadowed cliff and the cavern region is similar to the permanently shadowed region. So we would also generate 650 watts. So this is the power beaming facility at JPL. So we have a fiber laser with a wavelength of 808 nanometer that's fibered and then beams in free space towards the LPC device on the stage. So it's on a stage and it can be heated up to 500 C, and it can also be modified on another stage to be cooled as low as minus 170 C using liquid nitrogen. So we can test the LPC in extreme temperature environment, both very high heat and very cold. And so here the LPC size is 1 square centimeter, and the beam size is about half a square centimeter, which is half the area of the LPC. And the lab was approved for a class 4 laser operation. So that's why we could do laser power beaming experiment in the lab. So there are different types of laser power converter. And for each type of laser power converter, there is an optimal laser wavelength. For example, at 532 nanometer, the indium gallium phosphide LPC band gap is well tuned. For our case here, we used an 808 nanometer laser, where the gallium arsenide LPC is the optimal for this wavelength. But we also considered an indium gallium arsenide LPC, which would be optimal at 1064 nanometer. So that's the panel of different type of LPC and their respective wavelengths, laser wavelengths that would make the conversion optimal. So we can see we have expected efficiency in the near term between about 40% and 60%. In our case here, we considered both for our experiment, both gallium arsenide and indium gallium arsenide LPC. So the laser wavelengths that we used, 808 nanometer, is well matched with room temperature gallium arsenide LPC with a band gap around 900 nanometer for optimal power conversion. So we still use that laser with indium gallium arsenide, but we had some loss because of the unoptimized band gap between the band gap of the indium gallium arsenide and the 808 nanometer laser. So this is the experiment we did. So we used the laser that I showed previously, the 808 nanometer laser, and we varied the power between 4 milliwatts and 2 watts by steps of regular values. And we could see that as we increased the power of the laser, the short circuit current of the LPC increases as a function of the power of the laser. However, when we increased the power, we could see that the series resistance was penalized the efficiency of the device. And we were expecting to go higher than 50% efficiency, but we reached a maximum point around 50%, and then the efficiency decreased, the measured efficiency decreased due to the series resistance on the device. So if we didn't have this series resistance, this is how we were expecting the efficiency to increase well above 50%. So we worked with our collaborator SpectroLab, and they modified the contacts of the LPC to optimize them for large power, large amount of power. And they created some large area integrated contact to reduce or eliminate the series resistance on the device. But for the second round of experiment, instead of using gallium arsenide, we used indium gallium arsenide laser power converter that would be optimized for a 1064 nanometer laser, but that we tested at 808 nanometer. And this is the result of the experiment. So we can see the short circuit current is still proportional with the power of the laser, but we can see that we significantly and almost eliminated the problem with a series resistance. And even at high power, where we have 2 watts of power corresponding to 40 kilowatt per square meter, we didn't see issue with series resistance. So the current voltage measurement of the LPC was done while illuminated by an 808 nanometer wavelength laser beam. And this is what we saw for the efficiency. So the efficiency increased with the power of the laser, and then it stabilizes around 30% with the 808 nanometer laser. And we expect that if we had been using a 1064 nanometer laser, we would have reached, according to SpectroLab, an efficiency around 46% for this case. So this is the power density measured by this indium gallium arsenide LPC device, And so we have the highest measured power density of 12.1 kilowatt per square meter. And this corresponds to about 30 times a regular solar array at 1 AU. So this is the last, the far-term case for power beaming for deep space. And we did that study that was led by John Brophy a few years ago, where we have a laser transmit vehicle that has a kilometer scale laser aperture with hundreds of watt megawatt of power output, and it's space based and laser solar powered, and it beams this very large amount of energy through the solar system up to 40 AU to power a 100 meter scale receiver PV array with a very low areal density. And it's beaming the power through the solar system. So here we did a comparison between the laser power beaming with this very powerful laser and a standard photovoltaic, and we can see that at Jupiter we have about 100 times more power than what we would have with standard photovoltaics, with about 3.6 kilowatt of power. And even at Uranus and Neptune, we are about 300 times higher than what a PV array would generate. And that's here we can still reach powers of around 400 watts at Uranus and 160 watts at Neptune. So this is another study we did, which is closer to the midterm example that I showed, where here we have we are orbiting Miranda, which is a moon of Neptune, and we have very large solar array that are 60 meter by 60 meters. So they collect the low power from the sun and convert it to a laser. So they are so large that they can still generate enough power to beam the power towards the surface of Miranda to a lander. And this is so a study we did recently, where we can generate power with very light ultralight solar array with a laser beam. So this is the conclusion of my talk. So we could see that power beaming involves the wireless power transfer and could provide a revolutionary new way to power spacecraft and vehicles operating in difficult to access regions. Power beaming has the potential to represent an alternative solution to power spacecraft and landers where sunlight is unavailable. It could provide a source of power to robotic systems in permanently shadowed regions or power landers and rovers from orbiting spacecraft like the Moon, Mars, or Europa and Miranda that I just showed. And with our experiment, we could demonstrate about 12 kilowatt per meter square power beaming measurement on indium gallium arsenide LPC device that was demonstrated. So thank you very much for your attention.